Let's start the class. And now this week I'm at the MIT because it's not only the students at the ETH want to hear about the machine by D-Wave, but also the students at the MIT. And next month I have to go for a day to Harvard and to Stanford. But here now they have a nice video conferencing room so that I can now teach the class from here. And what you did in the first weeks is we asked you to write the code to calculate the machine precision. And we wanted the machine precision both for floats, for doubles, and for long doubles. And the question to you now is, how did you do that? How did you calculate it? You could write a code that has just a single main function and a long spaghetti code that calculates all three values. The second way of doing it is you can use functions, and you write a function for float, a function for double, and a function for long double, so that you have three functions. But those three functions basically do the same thing. So why call them differently? You could also have done just a function, epsilon, that takes then the argument float, and that's the one that does it for float, one that takes a double, and that's the function that calculates it for double, and one that takes a long double. But still, you have three functions. Or, if you've been smart, you could just have written a single function that works for all types. Were there many who wrote the function, a single one that works for all types? Could somebody who did that press the button and talk to me? Or did most write a single main function? Or did nobody do the exercise? The silence. So let me just simply tell you that this is a very common problem, that we have algorithms that work for many, many types that are generic. The codes you write typically use a single specific data type. For example, a minimum function is very generic. All we need is a less than relation. And we can define that the minimum of x and y is just x if x is less than y and is y otherwise. In this definition, there is no requirement of the type besides that there has to be the less than relation. So this works for integer, that works for doubles, that works for long doubles, that works for anything for which you can define a less than relation. But in most programming languages, you have to write a function with a concrete specific type. Like in C, we might write a function minint for two ints, and the function min float for two floats, and the function min double that takes two doubles. But the function body is basically always the same. Return a less than b question mark a colon b. And no matter what the type is, we have to copy and paste the same function body and duplicate it. But I told you already before, you should never copy and paste, because now we have to maintain three versions. If we have five types, we have to maintain five versions, and so on. But in Fortran, it's the same problem. Fortran has a built-in function min for the integers, a min for floats, and d min for doubles. Now, there's one big first advantage in C++ that I want to tell you, and that is that you don't have to give these functions different names, but you can call them all min. You can have a function min for two ints, and a function min for two floats, and a function min for two doubles. You can give all the functions the same name, as long as they have different arguments. And then the compiler, when you call it, the compiler then chooses which of the functions to call. Min of 1.3 calls the version that takes 2 ints. Min of 1.3 takes the function that uses 2 doubles. Min of 1.f, 3.f calls the function uses the function that has the floats. But when we mix, then it's harder. What if we call min of 1 and 3.14159 of an int and a double? There are a few solutions. We can either also write the 1 as a 1 point, so as a double type, and then it calls the function that uses double. Or we can cast the pi to 3. Okay, that doesn't make much sense, but it would work at least. Or we have a new function, min of int and a double. Now we can also take a min of int and a float, and int and a long double, and long and a double, and long and a float, and so on. And we have lots of functions that all in the end look the same. But let's not worry about that yet. At first, I want to look a bit more closely at the reason is why can we have two functions or three functions here that have the same name? How does it work? And there's another quiz that we could do. How can several functions have the same name? And one possible answer is, why should it be a problem? Now, I tell you why it should be a problem. And it should be a problem because when the compiler compiles a function, then it creates the object code. And in the object code, it writes there's a function with a certain name. And then the linker links in the function. But now there are three functions called min. So which one should the linker link in? That's why there's a problem. The second possible answer is, I don't know. Okay, that's a good answer because I will teach you about it. The third is the compiler uses magic. That's also okay as long as you think that the magic can actually be done. And the fourth is it's a problem, but I already know how it can be solved. Is there anybody here who knows how it can be solved? Okay, so if we don't know how it can be solved, then what we can do is we can look at what the compiler actually does when we compile this function. It's easy because we can just look at what is being done. Let me just make sure that you can see me. What we're going to do here. You're not seeing it. So I have to make sure you get. Let's see. So let me check that you get the feed. Okay, can you see it now?
Now no, but before yes. Now we can see.
Now yes, okay, good. So what we're going to look at, let me make it a bit bigger. We're going to look at the function min.cpp, a file here that I have. And here I have a few version of the min function, a min of 2 cars, a min of 2 ints, a min of 2 unsigned ints, of 2 longs, of 2 unsigned longs, of 2 floats, of 2 doubles, and then one inside the strange extern C block. That's like a C or a Fortran function. Now I'm going to compile this, but I'm going to save the temporary. I have to say, just compile, don't try to link. Now I have a few files. So let me now look at the min.ii, the preprocessed one. Okay, there's not much change. There's still the same code. Now let's look at the assembler file, min.s. And in there, just let's look for something called min. And here we see some symbol defined, C3 and then min cc. The next min we find something called min ii. We find something called min jj. Find something called min ll, min mm, min ff, min dd, and so on. And at the end, we should find something also called min. That's simply called min. So what is happening is that the compiler gives each of those functions a different name. When we look back at the min.cpp, the min.cpp file, then the min function of two cars is the one that turned into this min cc function name. The min of two ints turned into that min ii, and so on. And so the compiler takes the function and it appends some symbols that depend on the type. And all of those functions here get a different name once it's compiled. In C, you had to specifically manually call each function differently. In C++, the compiler does that for you. When you then go on and we look at the file min.o and we can look at the symbols in it with nm, then we see there's actually a function min.cc and a function min.dd and min.ff and ii and jj and ll and the function min. The function min is like the C function or the Fortran function. That's just a function with the name of the function name. But the C++ functions here all have the type appended to it. So let me now try to switch back to the PowerPoint presentation. And the question is, can you still see that?
Yes.
Okay, good, then it works. Let me zoom up a bit. Okay, so what happens is that actually the functions get different names. But if you want to call a C function or a Fortran function from a C library or a Fortran library, then there the argument types are not encoded in the function name. And to link to that, the function has to be declared as an external C function. When you do that, then the types are not appended. But it is still dangerous, because if we want to change one function here, we have to change all of those functions. We now had 6-7 functions that all did the same, and we don't want to maintain 7 functions. So what we can do instead is we can just use a macro. We can just say, no, let's not write a function, let's use a macro like in C, and we define min of a and b as a less than b, question mark a colon b. But that is dangerous for a few reasons. First, there is no type safety. A and b can be anything. That might be an advantage sometimes, but here it's dangerous. For longer functions, writing macros is clumsy. But what is more important is that this can have unexpected side effects. Just imagine if you call min of x plus plus and y plus plus. This does not call min of x and y, and then increments both, but this translates it literally to x plus plus less than y plus plus question mark x plus plus colon y plus plus, and variables get incremented twice. And that can be a bug that's hard to find. So what can we do? What we can do is we can use templates. A template in C++ is simply a way to specify that here's a function that works with many different types. I don't want to fix the type, but basically I make the type be another parameter to the function. So if I want to write a function min that works for any type t, And I just write the function as t min of t x comma t y, and I return x less than y question mark x, x colon y. But the question is, what is this type t? And because I don't know it, I write in front of it template class t. In German, template is a Schablone. So this is this template that tells you how to actually write the function min for any type t that you want to use it for. You just write template class t in front, and it works then for any type t. It works for many types t. It does not work for any because it will not work if it doesn't compile. And when does it not compile? It will not compile if there's no less than relation. So it will not work for complex numbers because there is no less than. But this will work for strings, that will work for ints and float and double and so on. Then it is fast, efficient, since it can be inlined. It is as generic and as abstract as the four-Meliot definition. It is a one-to-one translation of the simple equation to a code. And it does not involve any copy and paste. It just works. You write it once and it works for any type. How is this magic template then used? We write the template, and then I call it. And if I type and if I call it for 3 or 5, what happens is that the compiler sees I'm calling a function min with 3 and 5. The compiler does not find the function min for 2 ints, but it finds the template. Now it takes the template and it stamps down a new version of the min function. It's a min of int, where the type t gets replaced by int. Now it compiles the template with t replaced by int, and then that function gets called. Now I call it once more with 2 ints, x and 100, and here the compiler now uses the same function min of int, which it already compiled. Next, let me call it with 2 floats, 3.1459f and 2.7182f, 2 floats. What happens? There's no function min of 2 floats, but there's the template. The compiler takes the template, it stamps out a new function, min, where the t has been replaced by float, and that's what it compiles and then uses. I might then call it with 2 doubles, and again it works. So what we do here is called polymorphism. That is when we use different types with the same interface. I have a function min that works for many, many types, and it's always the same function min that works for any type. Or I have a plus, and the plus means the addition also for all possible types, for ints and floats and double and complex and so on. I want to ask you now, what are the advantages of polymorphism? So what are the advantages of using the same interface for many different types? Want someone to give me an answer here?
Excuse me, can you hear me?
Yes.
Just one question before we go to the advantages. What happens if you have 2 different types?
I think I'll be coming to that. Yes, what happens when I have 2 different types? Let me go back here. Let me say I call it with 3 and 1.4, with an int and a double. It will not compile because it will simply tell you there is no function that takes an int and a double.
Okay, thank you.
So now, what are the advantages of using the same interface for all types? There's no answer on the slides here, so you have to think an answer. If none of the students wants to answer, then is there a TA there? Is Michele there? Or Jan? Or Ilya? Or someone?
What's the question?
The question was, why do we want to use many different types through the same interface? I think you have to push the button. I can't hear you.
Why? So maybe because we want to write the function only once?
One is with templates, yes, you need to write the function only once in some cases, that's good, but to the other more advantages.
If we define our own types, then we do not have to write a new function.
Yes, if we use templates, we don't have to write a new function. Because we can just use the same function. And there's another advantage. What if I call the minimum for two ints foo, and the minimum for two doubles bar, and the minimum for two floats zorg? It's just horrible if you use different names for different types. You just want to keep it simple. You want to use the same. There's some feedback here. Somebody has the microphone turned on. So the main, there's negative feedback from somewhere. Could you please turn the microphone off? Okay, it's better now. So
maybe your microphone is too loud.
The advantage. The first is I have to write the function only once when it looks the same. That's with the templates. And the second is if it's always the same name, then it's much easier to remember it, and it's much less error prone. Now that we've learned templates, we can do what most people do when they learn this nice feature. They just start making all of their function template functions. So, okay, I might want to change the type double to float later on, so let me template everything on the type of the real number and so on. And then you get huge code with loads and loads of templates. That's what we all did at first until we realized that actually we never changed the type of double. So why did we write the template code here? And people then found out that the best way of using templates is to only use them once you have a real need of using the one function with two different types. So don't use templates just because you can use templates, but use them only once you actually want to call the same function with a new type. So let's say you need a function min, then at first you just write it for two doubles. And then only later, if at some point you need a min for two ints, then you go back and change the min function to a template to make it work with both. But start out writing normal function because it's much easier to debug. And then in the end, the best process is what is called the generic programming process. That is, you should write such template code only once you've seen several functions where you need to use them with different types. So what you should first do is you should identify useful and efficient algorithms. Why useful and efficient? It's very simple. If a function is not useful, don't waste your time on it. If a function is not efficient, don't waste your time on it. First find an efficient algorithm. Don't implement inefficient algorithms, only implement useful ones and efficient ones. Don't just write the function function just because somebody might need it, write it only when you really need it. Here, what was important is the algorithms, the plural, and we will see why in a second. Then the next step will be to find the generic representations. We'll use a min and a max function. We want to add on what should it actually do in the general case for all types. And then you have to figure out what do they have to work, what do they need to have in order to work in principle. Then you write it down for all your functions. Then you categorize them, sort them, improve it, make a framework and program it. We will do that at least twice, probably three times this fall. The first time is today with a simple example, namely we're going to write a min-max library that can calculate the minimum and the maximum. That already shows you the important steps that you should do when you think about template functions. So the first condition is think of useful and efficient algorithms, plural, so we don't only do the min, but we do the min and the max, and that will teach us quite a bit. The generic representation is that the min of x and y is x if x is less than y, and y otherwise, and the maximum is x if x is bigger than y, is greater than y, right? And y otherwise. Now we're going to write this down, and we're looking for the minimal requirements. What are the requirements here? The requirement is the minimum function needs a less than, the maximum function needs a greater than. Okay, so to use the min-max library, the type needs to have a less than relation and a greater than relation. That's what you do first. Then you ask yourself, are these really the minimal requirements? And you look back and you realize, no, they're not. Because I don't need to have both a less than and a greater than relation. I can also do it just using a less than relation. The minimum remains as before, and the maximum is just the maximum of x and y is x if y is less than x. So we can change the definition of max to use the same requirement as min. And now we would write the maximum also requiring only the less than. If we had only thought of a max function, we would have said, okay, let's use greater, probably. By looking at min and max, we realize it makes sense to use just one relation, less than, and not both. Can we make it even simpler? There is no. The only thing we require really is that there is a less than relation, and so we can now try to implement it. Here, let's implement this as a template. We have template class t, t min of tx and ty, and the return x less than y question mark x colon y. And the question is now, what are the requirements on the type t? And the answer is, what we need for the type t is we need to have a less than operator, but there has to be one more condition, namely the result of the less than has to be convertible to a boolean. If I have an x less than y that returns a boolean, then it's fine, that works. If x less than y returns an integer, 0, 1, that's also fine. 0, it will be false, and 1 will be true. If x less than y returns a string, then it will not work. So that's why here, this template function will work only if I have an operator less than, but the result is convertible to bool. Now we can test it by writing a type that only has that, and we see it will fail. Because implicitly here, we forgot something. What we forgot is copy construction. You see what we do here? Is we take the arguments by value, call it min of tx and ty. And what does a call by value mean? A call by value means the argument gets copied into the parameter. So here, this function has a second requirement, namely that we have to be able to copy the type. There needs to be a copy construction. Now this is more than the generic algorithm, and so we can think now again, can we improve it so that we don't need to copy it? And the answer is yes, we can. And we can by calling it with a const reference. Now it doesn't get copied. So this is now the best version that only needs the less than. I call the function min with two const references. So you see, we had the first function min that used the less than and needed a copy. We would have had the function max that needs a greater than. But by thinking about it in a structured way, we get the requirements down and we get to a better code. That's all. Except there was already the question, what if we call it with two different types? Now here's a very simple solution. What if you call it with a 1 and 3.141? Have a function. I just template data several types. Have a type U for one argument and a type T for the other argument. But what is the return type? What is the return type of a minimum of U and T? If I know the types, then I might be able to tell you if it's double and float, use a double. If it's int and float, use an int. If it's long and int, use a long. But in general, if I just know those are types U and T, what should I do? One way is that I add another template argument, R, for the return type. So I write template class R, class R, class U, class T. Okay, this text is actually wrong, I'm sorry. Class R, class U, class T. That's how it should be. Does this work again? Okay, so that's how it should be. That you have three arguments. Now, U and T can be deduced. When I call it with 1 and 3.141, then I know that U is an int and T is a double. But what is R? I don't know R, but what I now have to do is I have to specify the R when I call the function. I call here the min of double, and the double in the sharp bracket tells me that the first template parameter, the type is double. So in this function, it works for mixed types, but the disadvantage is I have to manually always specify the return type. Then in the function itself, I have to cast the values to the return type. Now, this is a version that works, but it's ugly, because now I have to always specify what is the return type. Does anybody have an idea how we can get rid of this return type? You can only do it if we have a way of calculating the type automatically when you compile it. Does any one of the students have an idea?
Well, the only thing I can say is that we have this list of more general types. If we have a mixed expression, then it is converted to a more general type. And if we somehow can implement this list, we can make a decision to what type we should convert.
Yes, so you somehow want to implement a list or a function that, given two types, returns the more general type. Do you know how to do that? So that will be exactly the way to go. We have to somehow make a list, or we have to make a function that calculates a type. So that will be a function that operates on types instead of variables, and that's called a meta function, and we'll learn about them in 2 weeks. Until then, you have to manually specify the type. In 2 weeks, I'll tell you exactly how to compute the type. But before we get there, there's one other thing that we have to do. Namely, we have to formalize a bit of when can we call this function. Because this function here, we said it needs a less than relation. And these things are called concepts. The concept is the set of the requirements that I need to be able to call a certain templated function. This requirement will be the valid expressions, like there must be a less than. There could be types involved, invariance, complexity, the guarantees and similar. So those are the conditions that a type has to satisfy. And any type that satisfies that concept, those conditions, that is called that it models the concept. So to specify such a concept, I have to define maybe types with it, valid expressions. Also have to specify the expression semantics, complexity guarantees, invariance, and maybe more. Why semantics? Let's say we have a less than. And not only have to require that there's a less than, but I also have to require that the less than actually implements an ordering relation. The less than operator should not add to numbers, but it should be a less than. But let's look at something simpler first. Something from the standard, there's the assignable concept. Assignable is just when you have a type that you can assign. So what is needed for assignable is that you can write just x equal y. When x and y are both objects of the type x, then x equal y this year, the assignment should be defined. You should be able to compile that. The return type should be a reference to x. The semantics should be that of assignment. And the standard writes here that what has to hold is that afterwards x is equivalent to y. So it has the same value. It's not required that it's bitwise the same, but it's the same thing. And the standard also requires then that there's a swap function that takes two values and swaps it. So that you can call swap and it swaps the two values. And the semantics of the swap with those values should be as if you were to manually swap it around. Then there's another similar concept called copy constructible. When can you copy it? He says, so you have to be able to copy it. And I think that will become more clear after we learn about classes. So let's skip that. What you can do as homework, though, is define a less than comparable concept. What are the requirements for less than comparison? Want you to think about it and tell me next week how I can actually define a less than comparable concept. And then when I document my template functions, then I do the same as before, but in addition to the precondition, the postcondition, semantic, and so on, I also have to document the concept requirements. For the min and max function, that will be just that it's less than comparable. And less than comparable will mean that there's a less than operator whose result value and so on. You have to think about that. Now I'm going to show you one more trick, namely, what if you want to write some template function? Like here we have a function compute that is templated on some type T, and in there I want to calculate the absolute value of the number x. I could write std colon colon abs, that's the abs function in the standard. But that function only works for the built-in types, for int and float and long and double and so on. It will not work for your custom types. Now, one way to make it work for your custom type is by implementing a function std abs in the namespace std for your custom type. Like here we have some namespace user and some class num in there. The problem with putting that apps function into the std namespace for the standard is that you're not allowed to do it. The standard forbids you from implementing a function in the std namespace. So what one can do is an idea due to Andrew Koenig. He said that if one calls in a template function, if one calls a function without any namespace, if you make an unqualified call like apps of x without any namespace in front, then where does it look for the function? It looks for the functions in the associated namespaces of the arguments. So if you call it with x, which is of type t, then it looks first if in the same namespace as t there's a function apps that takes the type t, then that's the function that's being called. So when you make your own template library and you need a function like apps in there, then always call it unqualified, like here, and then the user can provide their own function apps in their own namespace. So that's the function here, for example, if I call the compute function with my own type num, then the apps here refers to the apps function in the namespace of the type num. And that's the one that's being called. And only if it doesn't find that, then next, it looks for an apps function in the namespace of the function. So now I'm going to show you one example that's a bit more general, and then we make a break, and then we come to the next topic. What I'm going to show you now is the iterative methods for linear systems, and there are two books, thick books, that are called templates. There's a template for the solution of the eigenvalue problem and the template book for the solution of linear systems. What these books include is they include some pseudocode that tells you in a generic way how do you actually calculate, for example, an eigenvalue, or how do you solve linear system of equations here with in a generic way. This book does not provide any code because the books are meant to tell you how you would then sit down in Fortran and implement it for your specific vector type, for your specific matrix type, and so on. In C++, the big advantage we have is that we can write it directly as a template function once and for all types. I want to show that using the example of the power method. But I think before we go there, I make a short break of 15 minutes, and then I come back. I'll show you the power method, what it is, and then how we translate it to the C++ code. Other questions so far? If not, then I see you again in 15 minutes after a short break, and then we do the power method and then the CMake build system. Okay, shall we continue? Okay, so the power method, I sketched it here on the blackboard. What it's about is, let me go to the slide here. It's a method for calculating the largest eigenvalue and eigenvector of a matrix, of a Hermitian matrix A, so I need that A is the same as A dagger. And the idea is I start with a random vector x0 and then multiply it n times with the matrix A, so that the xn, the nth, the iteration is the matrix A applied to the n minus first iteration and normalized. So that the nth vector in the end is just the starting vector multiplied by the matrix A raised to the power n. And as I make n larger, that will converge to the largest eigenvalue and eigenvector. The vector will converge to the eigenvector corresponding to the largest eigenvalue of the matrix. How do we see that? To see that, let us find the eigenbasis, and let's call the eigenvectors of the matrix ui, so that a times ui is lambda I times ui, and we solve them so that lambda 1 is the largest eigenvalue. And now I'm going to write my starting vector x0 as a decomposition into the eigenvectors of the matrix A with the coefficient ci, and then I'm going to multiply it with the matrix A raised to the power n. What that does is for the component ui, the action of the matrix is just to multiply it by the eigenvalue. And so when I apply the matrix A n times, then there's a lambda I to the n factor coming in for every component. And the same here where I normalize it. It's the sum over I, ci squared times lambda I to the power 2n times the norm of the eigenvector that we assume to be normalized, so to be 1. And now the question is, where does that go in the limit n going to infinity? To see that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide it both up and downstairs with lambda I to, with lambda 1 to the power n. Down here under the square root, that's in the lambda 1 to the power of 2n. Now I'm looking at this lambda I divided by lambda 1 to the power n. I can write that like this, lambda I over lambda 1 divided to the power n. And down here I can write this lambda I divided by lambda 1 to the power of 2n. And what we know is that lambda 1 is the largest eigenvalue. So that this ratio for will be 1 for lambda 1, and for the other ones it will always be less than 1. And in the limit of n going to infinity, the ratio of a number that is less than 1 raised to the power n will go to 0. So this will go to 0 except when I is equal to 1. So what remains in the end is just the c1 times lambda 1 over lambda 1. Okay, that's 1. So it's just the c1 times u1. And downstairs is just the square root of C1 squared. So this will just go to C1 over the absolute value of C1 times U1. So it will converge to the eigenvalue, to the eigenvector corresponding to the largest eigenvalue. The only thing I have to do for that is I have to multiply the matrix, the vector, many, many times by the matrix A. And that's what the power method does. So we have it here on the slide. We start with a vector, the door that's random. We normalize it. We multiply it with the matrix A. We look at the scalar product of the new with the old one, That gives me the estimate for the eigenvalue. Then I'm calculating the residual, and when that is small, then I'm done. If not, I repeat it. So this is an 8-line example of how you can write down such a generic pseudocode for the power method. And in C++, we can just take it and translate it one-to-one into code. And here's the code. So it's just the same loop. And it's some operator A, that's my matrix type then, some vectors V and Y, there's some vector type that I need, but it can be very flexible. There are some scalar values, data, tolerance, and residual. And then I have my loop here. And now I want to translate the pseudocode into C++ code. The first thing I need here is that V is equal to Y divided by the 2 norm of Y. And what I write here is I write just V equal Y divided by 2 norm of Y. And that's the first requirement, that I need a function 2 norm for vectors that give me the 2 norm. Then there's another requirement that I need to be able to divide a vector by a scalar. And then there's a third one that I need to assign a vector to a vector. The next, I'm going to multiply the vector with the matrix. So I'm going to write Y equal A times V. That needs that for the matrix A, I have the operator star to multiply it. Then I need a dot product, let me call that dot. And you see, I call it unqualified. I don't write std dot or my namespace dot, I just call it dot, so that the user who writes then the type can specify their own dot product. And then I calculate the residual, and I loop until that is small enough. And what we started doing here is actually we started to write down a way to translating the functions that we need for the Hilbert space to the C++ code. And in order to do the concepts for the power method, we can either sit down and think about, okay, what are the concepts? What are the requirements? What are the expressions? What are the types and things and so on that they need to do the power method? And the big advantage we have here is that the mathematician have already done most of the work for us. Namely, they told us that the concept we need is the concept of a Hilbert space. So that's a vector space with the inner product. And what we can do now in defining the concepts, we can actually make use of what we learned in the math class and just translate the linear algebra the concept of the Hilbert space into a C++ concept. And the way we do that is we need basically three types. We need the type for the scalar, the type for the vector, and the type for the linear operator. We call them T, V, and op. And then we need to have lots of your functions defined. We need to be able to add scalars. R plus S for the scalars, R minus S, and so on, and just calculate the scalars. We need to be able to calculate the vectors, and we need to be able to multiply a vector by the matrix, and we need a norm function and the dot function. So that way we can now write down the concepts for the Hilbert space. The second part of the exercise is that you should try to sit down and think, are there things missing here? He wrote out all the complete requirements that we need for a Hilbert space. And that's where we're going to stop now with the templates. And what I want to switch to next is how do we build codes. And you already know that, let's see if this comes again, that to build codes, we don't want to write things by hand, but want to use make. And now you've all used make already in the homeworks, but that only works on the Unix system. And today I want to teach you about CMake, which is a cross-platform build system that works on all platforms. So it works on Unix and Linux, it works on Mac OS X, it works on Windows. So using CMake, you write a build file that is easier than a make file even, and the big advantage is it will work on all platforms and you can then build the code also on Windows platforms. The way it works is you write the build file that's called cmakelist.txt, and then you run it with cmake, and you can then create either a make file or the Xcode project or the Visual Studio project, and then use that to build the code on your platform of choice. Let's look at the simplest example. We want to again build our Square program. So we start file there that's called the cmakelist.txt, and it must start with the first line that tells what is the minimum version, and that's right now the 2.8. So we need CMake 2.8 for here. Those are the features we need. And then basically, to build it, we need only two lines. First, we have the project name, where project Square. And then I just want to say, in this project, I want to compile an executable program. So I write one line that's like a function call here add executable. There's the program name square one, and then I list the source files main.cpp and square.cpp. That would be enough, and now I could build it. If you want to have also a make install command, then I say in this fourth line here that I want to install the target square one into the bin directory under the path that I specify. So this is a three-line file, the four-line file that tells me how to build the program Square one based on the two source files main.cpp and square.cpp. And then I'm running CMake on it. I just want to show that to you now. And then I can just build it. And let me go to the sources. I think you lost the image now. I think you should be back now. Can you see it?
Yes, it works.
Good. Then I need to.
It used to work even before.
Hmm?
It was working even before.
Okay. So now we're here and we have the main.cpp and the square.cpp. And look here, the main.cpp is just again the main function that includes the square header and it calls the function square. And we have our function, our file square.cpp that includes the square function. And I could either manually type C++, minus O square, main.cpp and square.cpp, but we don't want to do that manually. So we could write a make file. But now we're not going to write a make file, but we have this CMake file here, project square, and the main line here, the add executable line. And now I'm going to create a build directory, make dir build, and I'm going into this build directory, and here I want to build my project, and now I'm calling CMake. And I have to mention it, the sources are one directory up, so I type CMake colon colon, that's where the sources are, and now it has created here a makefile. That makefile can be looked at, we have a makefile, and that's a huge makefile that you might want to look at. At some point, we're not going to look at that now, but what I'm going to do is I'm just going to type make. And it builds it here, and it links it, and when I look here, I have a program called square one, which I can run, and it works. I can also type make clean, and it cleans it, and the square one is gone. If you want to know what happened, I can type verbose equal one, make, and it tells me exactly all the steps it did, how it compiled it. If I look more closely, here it uses C++ to compile the main.cpp.o, and the next one, and then it links it. There's the linker here. So it made a make file, and I can also type make install. But it told me I can install it to use a local bin, because that was where I wanted to install it to. There are two ways of doing that. I can either do sudo, I'm root here, make install, can enter my password, and it installs it in to use a local bin. Or I can be smart and I say, what if I don't have access to root here, make another build one directory, and I can call CMake, and I define with CMake install prefix.
Can you please type a bit slower, because we cannot see everything. We have a bit of delay.
Okay, CMake minus D, CMake install prefix, equal, and now I tell it, for example, to install it into users Troyer, and then it, okay, and the sources are one level up. Now it built it, and I can do make install. Now it will install it into my home user Troyer bin. And that's where I can now actually find the function square one. It's here. So that was one thing. Now let me go back to the PowerPoint, and let's hope that still works.
Yes, it works.
So yes, we said,
yeah. Nothing, it works.
Okay, it works. Yes, with make, it built it, make clean, we looked at make install or verbose equal one make, and then I see exactly what happened. This can be useful to debug it. What I next want to look at is I want to look at how can I configure CMake more closely. What I'm going to do for that, I have to again, let me change the resolution again, that it works the best. 1024 times 768. What I can do in here, there's a file called cmake-cache.txt, and that's where it stores there are many things that I can look at by typing ccmake dot. That gives me a list of the variables that I can then customize. Here is the build type. The build type can be debug, can be release. There's the location where I installed it. And when I press the T key, then it shows me many, many more variables. Where's the compiler? User bin C++. What are the flags when I debug it? -G. The flags for release? -D and debug. Where's the C compiler? And so on. And here I can change the flags. Let's say for release I want to compile it with -03 to really optimize it. I can just change that in here. Say -03, -D and debug. Let's say I want to change compiler. That can be done here. Let's say I don't want to install it into UserDestroyer but elsewhere. I can just go to the cmake install prefix and change it here. So here I can change all of the build flags. Then I just go out and I can build it. Okay, nothing has changed here. But now I want to show you even nicer things. I mean, that was using a make file and using the command line. What I can instead do is I can instead open the cmake.app. There's also a nice GUI for cmake. And here I can just choose where's the source code. I browse for the sources, is the week 5 examples. Here's my cmake list.txt and I want to build it in UserDestroyer build lecture 5. I want to build it here, and I click on configure, and he asks me, this lecture 5 does not exist, do I want to create it? I say yes. Then it lets me choose how I want to build it, using makefiles, using Xcode, using Eclipse, Kdevelop, and whatever. I can just choose what I want to do. Let's just say I want to use a makefile again. And it shows me all of the options here, and I can just edit it like before, but in a nicer GUI. I can also do it and make another one, Lecture 5A, and configure it. And now I want to configure it using Xcode. Now in UserDestroyer build Lecture 5A, it created an Xcode project. We can look for that. UserDestroyer build lecture 5a. In here we have this square.xcode projects file, which I can open. Now I have here the Xcode IDE on the Mac, and I can just choose it here and I can just build it. Now it compiles it, build succeeded. And I have here the targets, there's the square, there are the sources. I can look into the square here, the cmake list.txt file. I have the source files. That's a different one. Open. Okay, let me see what is actually built here in cmake. Oh, I used a different one. I just want the week 5. No, wait, that was another one. Oh, that was the wrong one. I wanted to build this on this week 5 one, and I want to go to lecture 5b. Build it using Xcode. I generate it. That I have the correct project. The square here, the source files, no? No, we won't have this here. Ah, I hate GUIs. Okay. Have to generate it. Now I have it. I have the square one, where the source files, the main.cpp, the square.cpp. I can look at it, I can change it, I can compile it, I can make an error here, and so on, and it works. Then the other thing I can do is I can run the same thing on Windows. So let me launch here the CMake GUI on Windows. I choose the same directory, and I want to build it here now on Windows, and let me call it Lecture 5A. I want to configure it. It asks me, should I create it? I say yes. Can I make it a bit bigger? And I cannot choose which compilers, Visual Studio 11, 64-bit, I want to build it. It runs CMake in the same way. They're the same options, the installed prefix, I can generate it. Now it has generated the Windows. And I can find it. We go to here, and there's Lecture 5A. We go into here, I have this project square, which I can open in Visual Studio. And there's the same, and I can just build it. And it compiles it. Then I can install it and run it also on Windows. So that is one tool that allows you to build all of your codes on all platforms, on macOS, on Linux, on Unix, and on Windows. But I think here, in Switzerland, from what I've heard last time, is you don't program using Windows. So you may also use a make file then, but we would still prefer you to use the CMake because things are easier in the end, and because it would allow you to, in principle, pass the project on to people who use Windows. But what we've seen so far is just an example of making a program. Now, how do you make a library? Making a library is easy. You write the CMake file with just the function add library square, and we can make it a static library. Then we write here static, and then we write the source files for the library. Then I want to use the library in my program, so I have here the function add executable, call it square2 now, that uses this just the main file, and I want to link it against the library. That is specified by telling it the target link libraries, square2, that the program has to be linked against the library called square. And that's it to build it. And then I want to install it. I want to install the program into the bin directory and the library into the lib directory. And then I also want to install the header file into the include directory. And that's done by those three commands here. The program, the library, and the header file get installed. from the dynamic library, you just write here, okay, that should be shared. So that's a library, that's PowerPoint, it should be shared. That's a typo, I think, in the... So you make a shared library. And the rest basically stays the same. Let's try that. Week 5. So let's go here to the static case where we have a CMake list.txt file that made the static library. And I just type CMake dot to configure it. I can type make and it builds the library libsquare.a and then it links the program square2 against the library. I can run it. And I can do make install. Of course, because it wants to install into user local. I don't want to install it there. I want to install it elsewhere. So I'm using cc make. The install prefix I'm changing to users, destroyer, lecture. That's where it should install it to. Make another make install, and if I now look at user toy lecture, then there's in bin, there's the square2, in lib, there's the libsquare, and in include, there's the square.hpp. We can do the dynamic library. The same way, cmake, make. Now it has a dylib library. On Linux, it would be .so. What do you do if you want to let the user who compiles it decide whether one wants to build it shared or static? Okay, no, there's one question first. What is the difference between a shared library and a static library? Who can tell me that? Who knows that?
Well, a static library is part of the executable, and the shared library is loaded at runtime.
Yes, correct. And so the shared library is one that you do once, and multiple programs can use the same library. But with a static one, the program comes with a library, but it's bigger. We can just look at the size of the square3 here. The square3 is about 13 kilobyte. And now let's see what's with the static, the square2, it's a bit smaller. In this case, the size is not so much different because this is a tiny, tiny, tiny function. When it's a big library, then the statically linked one will be bigger because that includes the whole library. With the shared libraries, you make the library separately. The program will not include it, but it loads it at runtime as your colleague has said. The advantage of the static library is you just get a single program and it works. That's just the program here. Let's go back to the static one here. There's a program now going to delete the library and I can just still run the square2 program. It runs, it works because everything has been compiled into it. Let me go to the shared one, the shared library. I can call it, but when I look with OTool here, at this program, then it tells me it actually has to be linked against this libsquare.dylib at runtime. So if I remove the libsquare.dylib and want to run it, then it doesn't work. There's an error. It can't find the library anymore. So with the shared libraries, the programs will be smaller. You don't have to include the library that everywhere, but you always have to ship your program with the right libraries or it will not run. How to make a shared library really depends on your platform. On Linux is different than on Unix, than on macOS, than on Windows, and so on. With CMake, it was very easy to build it, and it will work almost everywhere. Almost because of Windows, there's a subtle issue that you don't care about because most of you don't use Windows. But let me go to another version now. We have one with an option. Here I want to have one where I can choose what to build. Let me first run it and then we can see what's happening. Here I can do cmake dot and I want to build it here and I go to ccmake dot. And here I have a new option, build square shared, which I can turn on and off. When I build it off, it builds it static. When I build it on, it builds it shared. Now it's on, and you can just make it, and it builds the dylib. Can do a make clean. CC make, I switch the build square shared to off. And I make it, and it builds a libsquare.a. Now I can easily choose whether I want it shared or static. How did I do that? Let me look at the cmake list.txt file, the magic one here. And here, the first key line is an option. See, there should be another option, build square shared. That is called build the square library shared. Okay, there's a typo. And by default, it's on. And then in the cmake file next, I make an if statement. If build square shared is on, then I set the square library type to shared, else I set it to static. And that set function here sets a variable with this name to that value. And then in the function called to the add library, I'm going to use that variable, square library type, which can either be shared or static. And the rest is the same as before. I'm going to show you another last example. That was this one here. And as the last example, we want to look at how can we actually change the contents of the file when I get the configure it. Let's say I want my program when I run it to also print the version number of the square library, and the version number I want to set in the CMake file. Or let's say I want the user to be able to configure some things in the source files. The way to do that is, first of all, I need to put placeholders into an input file where I placeholder where CMake should then replace something by a value, like here. All right, define square version major, and then between the at signs, I write the name of a CMake variable, in this case square version major. And the same with square version minor. And then I have a function's version that returns a string that uses that version number. But the version number comes from CMake. So the next step we do is, in the CMake file, I can set variables like square version major and square version minor. And now I can tell CMake to take that version.cpp.in file and create a new file version.cpp where those placeholders get replaced by the actual value of the variables. That I do with the function configure file. I give it the source file, which is in the source dir slash version cpp.in, and it should then make my version.cpp file in the binary there. The developer built it. And I think we just want to take a look at that. And see what that does. Okay, now it's state. Nice. So let me go to this version here. And in the version source directory here, I have this. So let me look at the square.hpp. The square.hpp now says there's a function square and a function version. And I have this version.cpp.in file, where I have these placeholders where CMake should replace that by the value of the CMake variable. Now let me call CMake in here. And CMake has created for me a version.cpp file. And here indeed the versions have been plugged in. That can be versions, that can be information on when it is built, where is it built, that can be options that you do, like I want to have a program that is debug version, non-debug version, I think so. I can just set variables here. Then to end this part, there are a few more functions that might be useful if you have a big project that includes the subdirectories. There's a function, a subdirectory that goes down into the subdirectories and builds things there. If you want to specify where you should look for include files, that's the minus capital I option. That's the function include directories here. There's one where you specify the link directories. There's one where you specify extra compile flags and so on. And then many more features how to make and you have the installer package, how to write the function in CMake, how to find the library, how to do loops, how to do the pattern matching and so on. Those are things that you can look up in the manuals or online, and some features you will learn in the next weeks. So you've learned how to use Make. You've used Make in the exercises. From now on, we want you to use CMake to build your files, and you should submit the homeworks using CMake to build it. And that way, we can test it by trying to build your programs on Windows. Now I want to start a bit about classes, because that's needed for the homework. That's in the last 5 minutes. What are classes? I think most of you had the basic C++ course, so you learned about classes already. But we have some students here who have never programmed in C++, so I want to quickly mention a bit about classes. And classes are simply a way of creating a new data type. Well, when I saw the need for that few times today, right, we talked about a vector type, a matrix type for the power method. We talked about some number types, and now we're going to teach you how to make your own types. And to make your new types, you write the class. And what you should do here is you should now not just ask what are the subroutines that I want to the feedback again. Could you please put the microphone wherever it is? So you ask the question, what are the logical entities? What are the abstract entities for your project? You don't ask just which function do I want to write, but first we want to think about what are the concepts, what are the entities. And we want to practice that on one example, and then we want to write a program for a simulation of nearby biological aging, of animals that live and give birth and die. And we could do a simple model that this would do. I can just write a model that is modeled after radioactive decay. Just say the death rate is proportional to the death rate is constant. I can't see much anymore. Okay, so the death rate is constant, and I'm just going to have a fixed number of animals die. That is dn is equal to minus lambda ndt. The problem of that is...
So we indeed lost your screen.
You lost the screen. Do you have it now?
Yes.
Okay. So we have a simple model that is this radioactive decay, but the problem here is there is no aging. The remaining lifetime of the atom does not depend on how long it already lived. So the distribution is wrong, and we need a model that contains some aging. The model we look at is the Penner model, and I think you heard a bit about it in the exercises yet, but it's a simple model where there are three assumptions. Namely, first, the animals need to reach a certain age until they give birth. They have genes that can mutate, and the resources are limited. And the model is the following, that each animal has a gene, and the genes are very simple. Genes is just that it's one gene per year, and the gene can be good or bad. There's one gene that controls whether in year one it becomes sick or it's healthy. There's a second gene that tells whether in year two it's been sick or healthy, and the third one and the fourth one. And the animal can survive, for example, two bad years. In the third bad year, so with the third bad gene, when it gets to that year, then it dies. But even if they are healthy, they might die because there is not enough food. And so there's the death rate also that depends on the population density. It might just die because it starves. Just dying is not good, so they can give birth to children by cloning with the certain birth rate B, but the cloning of the genes are not perfect, but some genes might switch. The bad one might turn good, or a good one might turn bad. And what you should do now in the homework is you should start to think about this model, and I don't want you to code anything yet. We just want some text. And what we want is the properties of this Penner model. What are the entities? That's pretty easy. You just think back of the model, and you look at the nouns I used. The nouns were genes, the nouns were animals, the nouns was population. So these three will become three classes we have to write. And what I want you to do this week in the homework is for these three ideas, for the genes, for the animal, and for the population, you should write down how would you represent it. How would you store the genes, or how would you store the state of the animal, or the state of the population? Then for each of them, I want you to think about what are the properties, like the animal, it can be alive or dead, it can have a certain age, it can give birth, and so on. So think about what are the properties. Then think about what are the operations, what are the things you want to do, like the genes you might want to mutate when you clone a genome. The animal you want to age by year. And then think about what do you have to do when you construct a gene, an animal, a population, what do you have to do when you destroy it? I just want you to think about and write down some text, and we will we'll discuss that before next week we start writing a program. So first for the panda model, which is described here with the animals, with the genes, when it dies and so on, write down what are the properties. And next week we learn how to turn that list of properties then into a class. Okay. That's it for today, and I'll be back in Zurich next week.